The president is obviously a very, very busy person. Their day is filled with a variety of things that they have to do and are responsible for. So what we're going to do for this next chunk of time here, we're going to look at all of the formal roles of the president of the United States. So when we say a formal role, we mean that this is outlined or alluded to in the U.S. Constitution. So there are several roles that the president has to fulfill, and we want to look at which of those we'll find in the Constitution. The first of these is that the president is what we call the chief of state, or in political science, we'd call this job the head of state. What this means is that the president is the ceremonial leader of the United States. They symbolize the nation. What this role means in day-to-day business for the president is that they are responsible for meeting important world leaders when they come to town. This doesn't just mean like leaders of other countries, but this means important world figures, you know, such as the Pope or the Queen of England or something like that. So even for ceremonial purposes, the president is the person who represents the United States in these meetings. They speak as the voice of the United States. When the president makes a statement on a world stage or at a conference, at a meeting or something like that, they are our representative. They're speaking with the voice of the United States of America. And so the president's role as head of state is incredibly important because they speak for the country and they symbolize the feelings of the country. I like to think of this job as what I call the mascot role. I think back to the Olympics in 2012, and these Olympics were held in London, England. And of course, the actual leader of the government in London is a person called the Prime Minister. But the symbol of the country for ceremonial purposes is the Queen. So when they're having the Olympic opening ceremonies, they bring out the Queen of England because she's a symbol. She reminds people of like pride in Great Britain and things like that. And the Prime Minister is the person who actually runs the government from day to day, but they're pretty boring. So in the United States, the president has to serve this role. When the Olympics are hosted here, the president of the United States is at the opening ceremonies. In the 1990s, the United States hosted the Olympics and the World Cup in very short amount of time. And Bill Clinton had to, you know, serve as the mascot of the United States for both of those important global gatherings. Head of state, one of the important roles of the president. This is kind of a ceremonial role and is more like foreign policy oriented and deals with how the United States interacts with the rest of the world. Next is the title we associate with the president, which is the chief executive. Now, this means that the president has all of the executive power, like we said in the Constitution. What this means is, you know, on the first day of our government stuff, we talked about legislative means make the law and executive means enforce or carry out the law. So this means that the president's job is to implement the policy. The policy gets made and it's up to the president to carry out the policy. They have to carry out the laws. And it's the Constitution tells them that they must faithfully execute the laws. So they have to carry out those laws whether or not they agree with the law. It's not the president's job to decide which laws they want to enforce and which laws they don't. It's up to them to faithfully enforce all of the laws of the country. They also have the power to do what's necessary to carry out these policies. So that was where we were talking in the Constitution. We were talking about the vesting clause and the faithful execution clause. The president has some elastic powers here. They have the powers to do what they need to do in order to turn these policies into actual action. Another constitutional role of the president is the chief administrator. When you hear administrator, you probably think about the school and the principals, who we call our administrators. Now, what is the principal's actual job at the school? They do a lot more interacting with me than they do with you. The principal's job is to manage the school like it were a regular workplace. And that's what the president's job is here as chief administrator. Their job is to serve as the manager of the federal government. So the president is responsible for running the government the same way that you'd run a business. They have a role in choosing employees. They have a role in budgeting, all these kind of things that are day-to-day business operations here. As the chief administrator, the president is the head of every specialized department. That's what makes up the cabinet. So the president's in charge of the State Department, the Defense Department, the Education Department, the Energy Department, on and on and on. The president's the head of each of those specialized departments, and they choose the leaders for those departments. The presidents have a major role in controlling the budget, while it's up to Congress ultimately to write the budget and decide how the money is spent. The president can approve or veto the budget just like any other policy. And so the president does have a tremendous say in what the budget priorities are. The budget process is heavily influenced by the president. The president hires and removes federal employees. When a new president takes over, they can replace some of those employees, so they can decide which ones to keep and which ones to put their own people in. This is similar to the manager of any business, is hiring and firing and choosing employees. The president also makes decisions about how laws will be enforced. So, for example, we know that, you know, illegal drugs are illegal in the United States. President Obama made a choice to prioritize more dangerous drugs like heroin and methamphetamine, and to not prioritize marijuana enforcement in his time in office. He thought that those harder drugs posed more of a problem for society. President Trump, as administrator, when he's making the same decision, he chooses to prioritize marijuana enforcement because he thinks that is a dangerous problem for the country. So the president does get to make choices in how those laws are carried out. Very important role. We have to know this one by name. This is, the president is the chief legislator. And that means that the president is in charge of lawmaking for the government. They are not a lawmaker. They are not in Congress. They do not have a role in the House or the Senate or anything like that, but they do have the final say on every policy passed by Congress. They either sign it to approve the law or they veto it to reject the law. But the president also has a huge role in recommending the law. And that's what usually takes place during speeches like a State of the Union address or something like that. The president outlines what they think are the priorities for the policymakers, and the president has tremendous sway over the people to encourage public support for the president's priorities. So the president says yes or no to any law that Congress is passing. The president proposes laws that they think Congress should be passing. And the president has the ability through executive order to effectively make laws on their own. Executive orders are not as long-lasting as laws that are passed by Congress. They can be replaced by the next president that comes along, but they have the same effect on us in terms of types of policy. So the president can issue executive orders, and those basically do the same thing as laws in a lot of ways. And so here the president has a lot of power over legislation or lawmaking. So as chief legislator, we want to remember that the president recommends policy. We want to remember that the president approves or rejects any policy. And we do want to remember the fact that the president can make policy changes on their own through executive order. Another role of the president is they are chief diplomat. This means that they are in charge of foreign policy making. They're in charge of maintaining relationships with other countries and with our allies and organizations around the world. So part of these powers come from the fact that they choose the ambassadors for every country in the world that the United States has relationships with. So by choosing the ambassadors, this is an important power of the president to influence the way policy is made in those countries and to influence the relationships with those countries. Another very important power the president has is they decide which governments we're going to have relationships with. This is what we call diplomatic recognition. This is a little complicated and has more to do with the other countries of the world, but this is where the president can recognize a government as the official government of a particular place. So, for example, if another country were to have like a revolution and there were two rival groups that were claiming to be the rightful government of the state, the President of the United States makes the choice of which of those governments we're going to deal with and which of those governments we're going to say are illegitimate. The President has this power on their own. They make this choice alone, and this is not something that Congress votes on or gets to decide. It's the President who accepts the ambassadors from those countries. And as chief diplomat, the President also has important powers to negotiate treaties with other countries. And another thing we'll talk about would be executive agreements. Much like executive orders, the President can come to executive agreements with other world leaders. And finally, the one you're probably most familiar with, the President serves as the commander-in-chief. This means that the President is in charge of all of the United States military. Now, this is, like we mentioned back when we were talking about Article 2, this is kind of vague. We don't know specifically what it means, but the President is the main decision maker. They make decisions about how to use the military. They make decisions about all the different branches. They make decisions about when to use the military. The President is the head of every single branch of the military. Congress has some military powers, like we mentioned earlier. Congress raises armies, Congress can regulate the armies, Congress declares war, but the President has the power to make war. So that means that the President is the one making the decisions when the military is being used. Now, this is the role that has changed the most from our first president, George Washington, all the way to our most recent president, President Biden. Commander-in-chief to George Washington meant that he was actually going to be out with the troops, and he would be moving around on a horse, you know, making decisions about how the troops were going to interact with their enemies and make decisions about troop movements and things like that. As time evolves, the presidents gain more and more power. As the military becomes more and more advanced, the presidents make decisions about places to bomb or what types of bombs. All the way up to under President Obama, we're talking about the President has the ability to just have drone strikes that essentially assassinate leaders of international organizations that the United States sees as hostile. And so both President Trump and in the future President Biden have tremendous abilities to make decisions about how to go to war, how to make war, when to strike places, and how to interact, how to use our military in these ways. So with President Trump, he announced that he wanted to create a space force, so it's up to the President to decide that he wants to expand the military into outer space for the United States. And you know, we'll see what Biden's priorities as Commander in Chief become. But Commander in Chief is an incredibly important role for the President, probably the most important, because ultimately it is up to the President to maintain the safety and stability of the United States. All right, so these were the formal roles of the President of the United States. So all these things we can find in the Constitution, maybe not in these exact words, but these six roles are things that we find in the Constitution, and the President must constantly be fulfilling these roles all the time. We're going to talk about a couple of roles that the President has to fulfill that are not found in the Constitution in just a minute.